project is Art Under Repression, a Soviet Jewish woman's struggle for artistic freedom. Under the rule of Stalin, there were strict laws in place on what was acceptable for an artist to create. Those who went against this and took part in what was called the underground avant-garde movement could be severely punished and had an extremely difficult time practicing their art. Jewish artist Leah Ratner from Moscow was an inspiration to me as I set out to write a creative piece about a Jewish artist living under the Iron Curtain. I will begin by discussing the process that went into writing this piece, and then I will read the opening scenes of my story and movement through time. My original plan was to write a historical nonfiction piece focusing on Leah Ratner's triumph over the social forces working against her as a Jewish artist up until the 1980s in Soviet Russia. Though after I met with and interviewed an American man who had spent time in Moscow in the 80s, and he was a great friend to Leah, I found that I had a wealth of information that covered much more than Ratner's life. Our conversation, which began by focusing on Leah, had expanded to such interesting events as secret religious meetings held in someone's apartment late at night, a school created for the deaf who had become forgotten members of society, and the heavy censorship that kept citizens from learning about the non-Soviet world. Additionally, I read a lot of Russian literature from the 19th and 20th century to give me some ideas on, because I wasn't completely up to date with Russian history, and especially during the Soviet Union, and that helped me also a lot, or gave me a lot of ideas of other things I could include in the story as well. So after this, I decided that I didn't want to be restricted by the nonfiction genre and turn to fiction, which would allow me to bring in other characters in political and social events. By blending fact and fiction, I could tell the story of a struggling artist while allowing myself the creative leeway that I felt necessary for bringing life to the story. So now I will read to you the opening scenes of A Movement Through Time. Leah had been holding one of her mother's hands tightly as they walked home from the market. Her younger brother Ivan had held the other. She could hear her brother purring a song in Yiddish, the one their father often sang to them at night. His soft voice mingling with the falling flakes of snow had a calming effect that seemed to even place their mother under its spell. They walked along in tune with each other, leaving their footprints, a large set surrounded by two smaller ones behind. They had been walking some time for that way, alone in near silence, interrupted only once when two men in long brown coats who were headed for the train had passed them. Through the white, Leah could make out a group of male forms a couple hundred feet away that were jerking around in place, as if involved in some sort of strange dance. Her mother tugged on her hand and their pace was suddenly broken. They stumbled forward in disorderly steps for a few feet and then stopped. Her brother's song sounded forced and caught in the air. "Shh," her mother hissed. Squinting now, Leah made out a circle of young men surrounding a middle-aged man with a black beard and dark eyes. He was pushed around so he bounced from one set of hands to the next. The men kicked out at him without making contact. "Traitor," one of them shouted. "Dirty Jew," said another. "Filthy brute." Leah looked up at her mother, who had hurried them across the street, and now had Ivan clutched in her arms. Her jaw was clenched. Leah still glances at her face for the rest of the hurried walk home, and at one point noticed she was crying. Inside their apartment, Leah lay on the floor, using her hands to rub warmth into her arms. She could hear her mother singing in a low voice to Ivan while she bathed him in the bathroom down the hall. Leah stared at the ceiling without really looking at it. "Jew," she let the word roll off her tongue. She said it again, leaving her lips pursed long after the word had left her mouth. It sounded foreign now, though she had heard it many times before. "Jew," she growled at this time, trying to invoke the grittiness that she had heard on the street. This childhood memory had always stuck with Leah. It marked the moment when she understood that her privileged lifestyle wasn't impenetrable, that she rested unsteadily on the outskirts of society. She thought of it now as she stood waiting, watching the skies that began to lighten. It was just before 7. She had been in the queue for 3 hours now. She stamped her feet to try to warm them, the newspaper insulation inside her boots somehow failing her this morning, and passed the time counting the row of heads in front of her, two gray-haired women who looked just a few years younger than herself were chattering quietly. leaning in close to each other to avoid losing the little heat that their parkas were holding in. Leah pulled out a cigarette from inside her coat. She hated these still moments when she couldn't keep from thinking of her lost husband and son. They had been sent to the gulag years before, and she had heard from them rarely, until one day the letters ceased coming altogether. And after a few years, she was forced to quit waiting, saving herself from becoming like some of the widows around her who spoke in solemn, incomprehensible whispers, their appearance disheveled, their eyes framed by wrinkles, somehow still hopeful. But even now, over 40 years after they had been taken from her, there wasn't a day that went by when she didn't imagine their gaunt faces as they moved about the work camps, eagerly waiting for the day they would be let out, but all along knowing they would likely die there. She puffed on the tightly rolled cigarette, small flicks of tobacco touching against her lips, and pushed forward as the crowd behind her did. The queue had doubled in length, and those outside the shop stores were shoving to get inside. She could now see the stiff-lipped man who was running the counter. He stood rigidly, his arms crossed over his chest, as if worried the crowd of babushkas would rush forward and overtake him and his goods. There were just three heads in front of her now. She could hardly wait to get back to the warmth of her apartment. She thought she could make it home before the soft lights of the morning disappeared from the pond that lay below her window. The man grunted at Leah in greeting without bothering to look at her face. His goods were growing scarce, she noticed, and became suddenly thankful that she'd come as early as she had. He handed her a small loaf of bread and half a block of cheese, enough to last her, without any other mouths to feed, 2 or 3 days. Leah thanked him and pushed past the other elderly woman, who looked longingly at the bundle she clutched to her chest. Outside the window, the sun was beginning to set, casting a still light on Patriarch's ponds. Leah stood, her easel facing the water, adding strokes to her painting, a landscape of blues and greens. A slight smile curved her lips as she considered the child version of herself sitting in the open field she was creating, the sun a soft buzz on her bared arms. She had summered with her family in the countryside throughout her youth, and though the memory was nearly 80 years old now, she still remembered the long hours spent with the prima ballerinas of the Bolshoi and the Kirov, who practiced near their summer home. The ballerinas were family friends who had at once taken her in as their own. Then, she had dreamed of one day taking the stage and twisting and turning under brilliant light with other girls like herself who'd shown promise. A knock at the door startled her, nearly causing her to drop the brush whose worn bristles were beginning to stiffen. She carefully dipped its end into a small jar of water, dabbed it on a piece of cloth, and then laid it on its side and moved toward the door. "Jenny," she said, and stepped aside so he could enter. She took his coat and hat, hanging them on the coat rack by the door, and then led him over to the two chairs that crowded around her table and sat him down, straightening the white cloth that was spread evenly over the table's surface before moving to the kitchen to boil some water for tea. A few years after her son was sent to Siberia, one of Leah's friends, considered a foremost painter like herself, introduced her to Jenny. He was also an artist but worked for the state. Although the works he created were commissioned, there was still an originality to his paintings that showed through in the dark shadows around a small girl's eyes, or in the rusted colors of an old woman's smock. The two soon began to meet on their own late at night in Leah's apartment, where they spoke of the underground movement that so many artists were becoming involved in. Excitedly, he would ask Leah how she felt about being a part of this moment in history, his eyes never strained from the landscape or portrait she happened to be working on at the time. His boyish enthusiasm had at once filled Leah with nostalgia and offered a comfort that she had at first out of guilt resisted. "It's beautiful," Jenny said, gesturing toward the painting. She smiled over her shoulder in response. He set a package wrapped in brown paper, a tight knot of twine, tied at its top onto the table. "For you." Leah brought the samovar and 2 cups to the table and sat. "Thank you," she said, placing a hand on top of the gift as if to open it, and then instead pulled a cigarette from a small wrinkled pack and offered one to Jenny, who waved his hand toward her and pulled a matching pack from his pocket. They sipped at their tea and Leah listened while Jenny spoke of his latest commissioned work, a gray-scaled mural that depicted a line of women working in the field, their babies strapped to their backs. The conversation moved on fluidly, beginning with a discussion of the newest censorship laws, the growing underground publications, and then as usual expanding to the non-Soviet world, their voices out of habit dropping to just above a murmur while their intonation only grew stronger. Around them, the room had turned hazy with smoke. "An American?" Leah asked. Jenny nodded, working for the State Department. Leah looked out the window. The pond was hardly discernible under the weak light of the moon, its expanse littered with the slanted shadows of the surrounding lindens. The trees always looked welcoming to Lee in the daytime, but seemed predatory at night. She held her cup just below her chin and blew on her tea. "And he will be here only a short while?" she asked. "An end date hasn't been set for the project." Jenny let his voice trail and then stretched his arms above his head. "I should get to the studio before it's too late." "Of course." She moved to the coat rack and held his jacket and hat out to him. He took them from her and they said their goodbyes before he headed out to the icy streets. Once he was gone, Leah walked to the table and opened the small package, 3 new brushes. She picked up one and ran the soft hairs of its tip over the back of her rough-skinned hand, glancing toward her painting. Closing her eyes and picturing the satin slippers, the intricate costumes, the long days spent relaxing in the fields, she let her childish dreams pass through her again. The high rises around Moscow that stretched their necks well above the other buildings transfixed Leah. They seemed to promise something immutable, something that couldn't be demolished on a whim. She stood at the base of Sparrow Hills, looking up at Moscow State University, letting her eyes run along the sharp edges of the building's outline, remembering from a different time its skeletal frame. Over the years, she had come here alone when she could, and a deep-rooted yearning would grow in her each time she stood before its vastness. She had applied to Moscow State University, where she had hoped to study architecture at its previous location along with 2 of her secondary school friends, and was sure they'd all be accepted, but only a few months later she received word of rejection at the same time that her friends were accepted. It hadn't made sense that the other two, who'd always made lower marks than her in school and didn't do as well in the entrance exams, were chosen over her. It was as if the university had selected at random, tossing Leah's application to the floor with their eyes closed. Her family knew this was a result of their Jewish heritage. Leah knew this as well. But they kept quiet and watched as she stubbornly applied the following year, only to be rejected again. A chill that caught in the collar of her coat had her repositioning the black scarf around her neck. The snow crunched beneath her boots as she moved toward the field that was a luminous green in springtime, but looked bland now, all blanketed in white. She stopped at the edge of the field, tentatively raised a foot above the unmarred snow, and then planted her felt boot in. She slowly raised her other foot and pushed it into the snow inches from the first. 2 distinct crevices formed about her ankles. The snow that crept into her boots didn't concern her. She stepped back and looked at her mark. Leah then turned and walked briskly toward Sadovia Street to meet the American. Thank you.